friend. We do email out the sermons every week beforehand. Just get them to email you that very, very quickly. So we're actually going to a series on the life of Jesus. And on Wednesday, what was preached was about Jesus being up the transfiguration, an incredible time. Jesus being changed by prayer. Peter saying something stupid. Basically, everybody seeing the three prophets of prayer being Moses, Elijah, and now Jesus. And it was a real pivotal point in his ministry. It's about a year and a half in, and from then on, he's going towards Jerusalem. So, starting in Luke 9:37, it says, the next day. So the guys have come down from the Mount of Transfiguration. It says, the next day when they came down from the mountain, a large crowd met him. Now, he'd been up the mountain with Peter, James, and John. So that's all. So all the other disciples had been left. And then, carrying on in Mark chapter 9, verse 14. My first, actually the title of the message, I forgot, is why things do or don't happen in your life. You ever wondered why that? Why is that guy blessed and not me? Why great things happen in that guy's life? Well, point number one, what's your problem? What is your problem? You ever stop to ask yourself that? What the heck's wrong with me? No? Okay, maybe it's just me. Okay. All right. Mark 9, verse 14. It says, when they came to the other disciples, they saw a large crowd around them, and the teacher of the law arguing with them. As soon as all the people saw Jesus, they were overwhelmed with wonder and ran to greet him. What are you arguing with them about? He asked. A man in the crowd answered, teacher, I brought you my son, who is possessed by a spirit that has robbed him of his speech. Whenever it seizes him, it throws him to the ground. He foams at the mouth, gnashes his teeth, and becomes rigid. I asked your disciples to drive out the spirit, but they could not. You ever felt like that, disciple? Just, what's going on? Nothing's happening. First thing is Jesus was away. And so we see the disciples going back to who they really were. Let me ask you today, who are you when Jesus is not around? That's the real you. Yeah. That's the real me. When nobody else is around. Yeah. Here is disciples, rather than being humble, they couldn't do what Jesus could have done. So they get into an argument with the Pharisees about the law. Well, you see, the reason I can't do it is I'm not like the guys in the Bible, and the scripture says that, and there's grace here, and, you know, the real reason is if you understand the scriptures properly, and, you know, you've got to understand if you look at the law this way, that's the real issue. You know, when we can't make things happen, as human beings, we love to blame everything else but ourselves. You know, the critics were really quick to pounce on them. You can't do it. You see, look here, I mean, when things don't go your way, it's amazing how the critics come out. As a Christian, you ever been at work, and you've gone in, and maybe you're not happy, and one of your non-Christian friends goes, why are you not happy, Christian? What's wrong with you? Aren't you going to be joyful always? You go and you talk to your non-Christian friends, but I feel like my prayer life's not working. Why are you in sin? I've had those conversations. I've had totally had those conversations. You're like, dang, I ain't going to tell them nothing anymore. You know, they got into this whole concept where they were trying to win an argument with the religious people to justify themselves. You know, when we're not trying to imitate Christ, when we're not being Christ-like, we can be just like the disciples. Argumentative, proud, defensive, blaming everybody else apart from ourselves. People have a habit of projecting their problems on other people. Have you ever said, you made me sin? Husbands, wives, well, if you treat me nice, I just wouldn't have got angry with you. You made me sin. Last time I looked, my sin was my sin. Or, well, because of you. Or, you should have done this, it would have made me do better. We project our problems, our weaknesses, our lack of faith on everybody else but ourselves. You know, sometimes we go, go, well, the reason I'm not fruitful is you've got to understand the university I go to, it's not really an open university. And if you had my Bible talk or my Bible talk leader or my discipler or, you know, if you had my exams or in my situation, if I can project this onto you, then you will agree there's no way that I can bear fruit. Doesn't matter if the Bible says that the harvest is plentiful, the issue's not with me. Or special. Well, you've got to understand my circumstances. I haven't got money, I haven't got this, and my car just blew up, and this and that. Well, you've got to understand. And how dare you ask me for it? Oh, well, you know, I can't pay my rent because I lost my job. That's pretty obvious, right? It's logical. I can't pay my contribution because I lost my job. Like, you're never going to lose your job. If you don't plan for losing a job, if you don't plan for special coming a year in advance, if you don't plan for all of that, it's your fault. You know what would be really terrible? Is if it wasn't your fault. Because you can't repent of somebody else's sin. I mean, the great thing to find out is that it's actually your fault. Because then you can do something about it. But while we project it onto other people and go, it's your fault, well then, you just got to wait for them to change. You know, the real issue is you, or me. As we read the rest of this story, we see that Jesus did go on to heal the boy. But in Mark 9, verse 28, it says, after Jesus had gone indoors, his disciples asked him privately, why couldn't we drive it out? You know, too many of us are too scared to ask the question.
Yeah.
What is wrong with me? Why can't I do it? Why can't I pass my exams? Why can't I have a great relationship? Why can't? You know, we're just too scared to ask the question. Because we know what's coming, we won't like. And Jesus says to them, well, it's all my fault, I should have been here with you. No, that's not what he said. He replied, this kind can come out only by prayer. He said, the difference between you and me is not that I'm the Messiah, it's not that I have these amazing powers, or I'm God in the flesh. The reason why I go around making things happen and you don't, is you don't pray. You know, too many times we hit a wall. We study with a lot of people that don't become Christians, and we try hard. And instead of getting really determined and pray, we go, I'm going to give up. What's the point? God doesn't answer. You don't understand that. Our enemy is Satan. He's not a weak being. He's not pathetic. He deceived one third of the entire angels that ever existed to follow him and rebel against God. The fact that Christian life gets a little bit hard sometimes should not surprise us. And yet too often we are shocked. And yet Jesus says, you know what? The answer is prayer. Sometimes, in some versions it says prayer and fasting. You know, I was convicted, Dean was preaching this Wednesday, and he was saying, you know what? Why don't we believe our prayers are answered? God even answers non-Christians' prayers.
Yeah.
I was like, dang, that's a good point. But something happened actually about 3 weeks ago that really convicted me. I was studying the Bible with Ovi up in Macquarie, and they have a world map there. And he's got some passion about some political situations up in Nigeria. And he was talking about how can you wrestle with these things. And we were just having a casual conversation, you know, what's the way to change the world? Is it to join a political party or be a militant or whatever? And we were just talking, I said, that's not the way, you've got to be like Christ. And because we were standing on the world map, I said, look at what people have done over the years. I said, think about India. Mahatma Gandhi kicked the British out of India by doing what? Fasting. Martin Luther King led a pacifist movement of prayer and fasting to change America. Mahatma Gandhi was not a Christian. never claimed to be. And it convicted me. You know what? Fasting works whether you're a Christian or not. It's just one of those things that God goes, this man desperately wants this to happen. I am paying attention. And it just really convicted me. Because you know how we all feel about fasting. But it's amazing. If you feel like you make a decision fast or somebody tells you fast and your heart's not in it, it is the most horrendous experience. You know, like an hour is now 20 hours. And then you get into this, so can I drink tea? Tea with sugar, a milkshake, a fruit juice, it's still liquid. I mean, it's a mess. We've all been there, okay? It's just a mess. But when you have set your heart on fasting, you don't even think about it. You don't even think about it. Because your heart is in the right place. The issue is not, can we change the world? The issue is, are we going to have such a radical prayer and radical fasting life that God will use us? That's what he told the disciples. It was a really simple answer. Now, Matthew 17, verse 19. There's two accounts of this conversation, and you have to match them. In Matthew 17, 19, it says, then the disciples came to Jesus in private and asked, why couldn't we drive it out? He replied, because you have so little faith. Truly, I tell you, if you have faith as small as a mustard seed, you can say to this mountain, move from here to there, and it will move. Nothing will be impossible for you. You know, Scotty told me that, you know, when he read this as a kid, he'd sit there in Sonora and look at a mountain and go, like, stop moving. And I know he's not the only one to have done that. The truth of it is, when he talks about a mountain, the Old Testament refers to a mountain as a nation. He's telling these disciples, you're going to move nations. Jews would have understood that. They're like, what? He goes, you've got to understand, our faith is so small. You know, the reason we don't pray is because we don't believe.
Right.
They're interconnected here. Faithful people know they have to get on their hands and knees. They know they have to fast. Why? Because they know at the beginning of those prayers, they don't have faith. But they go, I am like Israel, like Jacob. I mean, it said God changed Jacob's name to the man who wrestles with God. He said, I'm not letting go of God until you bless me. The reason things don't happen in people's lives is because they really don't want them to. They wish them to, but they don't want them to. You know, let me ask you, how small is your prayer list? How small or infrequent are your prayer times? You know, you get what you consistently pray for. That's a fact. That's a fact. So I can see how my and your prayer life is going by what's happening in your life. You know, actually what happens in your life will judge where you're at. It's just the truth. How small is your prayer life? When was the last time you just fasted for something because you wanted it so much? Prayer changes nations. It'll change everything around you. You know, I'm a forgetful man. I'm getting old, amen. So, I have a cup with everything I want to see happen. This is my cup for this year. And this is what I'm praying and fasting for. Very, very simple. At the beginning of the year, I wanted to go to Jerusalem. We booked our tickets to Jerusalem. That seemed like a far-off dream. I want the kids to get their driving license. That's a scary dream. Okay. I want us to be able to buy a house. We didn't have the deposit. That seems to be coming. Pass my ICCM exam. That's coming 1 week before Manila. So please pray for me. I haven't done past the first bit. I want the church to grow to 65 and break even financially. As of today, we will be at 60 members. I want to be a size 35. Now, Scotty saw this and giggled. He said, you're cut, man. I still have one about size. Giggle. I have 1 inch to go. Kids to become Christians. get?
Nothing.
New Year's Eve, this is getting smashed. In the Garden of Gethsemane. Woo! That'll be a moment. I'll have my last cup of tea then. Thank you, Jesus. Where's your cup? Where's yours? It's above my desk every day. Every day I can pray for it. What do you got? Thank you, small baby. God is amazing. I thought we were pretty awesome praying for a free church. Remember that? 2 years ago, we got a church for $100. I've just been outstripped. So Carlos was here from Mexico, okay? Doing our meditation was really, really great. Well, we were talking this week with Kip, and he went down there. He said, you know, it's an interesting thing that's happened to Carlos. He said they've been studying the Bible with this guy, and their daughter has come, and their father said, you know what? Where you're meeting is not good. Kip said, I'm telling you, it's really not good. Like, you have to see baptism through a grate and move to Mexico City. And so her father had a vision. Now, this gentleman, should we say, comes from a very dubious background in Mexico. Let me just say no more. And because of it, he started to try and change his ways. So he had a vision. He said, I had a vision from God that I should tear down my garden on my multi-mansion and build a church just for you. So my daughter can come and be baptized in a nice place. And Kip said, you know, when he got there, he was really tired, but, you know, he said, can I show you? He said, this thing is huge. It's three stories, the best marble flooring, the whole back street has lights and sonic sound and like. I'm like, yeah, my prayer-free church seems pretty small right now. But you see, when God's involved, unbelievable can things happen. You know, too many of us don't think we can change nations. I remember as a young Christian, now some of you are not going to relate to this, in Imago World, I remember being brought up in the Cold War. All the movies were Russia against America, and all like this. And I remember praying, God, bring down the Berlin Wall. And we all started praying for the Berlin Wall to come down. And I remember we set the church into Russia, it all came down. I remember praying for apartheid to fall. We sent a church to South Africa. We were the church that had whites and blacks mixing way before apartheid came down and apartheid fell. I believe absolutely they are the answers to our prayer. I believe our prayers will see the fall of communism in China. What are you praying for? That you can have a good date on Saturday night? I mean, get a grip. You know, there are so many things that if we just start to pray for. So glad of the students. I love speaking to parents. They go, does your church focus on studies? Oh, yes. How as a Christian, if you don't get great studies, can you evangelize other students? How can you persuade people that spend 18 hours a day in a university library studying, go, become a Christian? You can have just as good grades, but less commitment, unless you have great grades. You know, Jane's in China. She got a result. She was top student at University of South Wales. Top! Tim's grades have doubled since our conversation. Leo passed his exam. See that on Facebook? He's everywhere. You know, there are so many, but it takes devotion to God and studying hard. It takes fasting for God to write the right questions that you want on that exam paper. Oh Lord Jesus, as you're writing these, please put them on there. Or help me remember the ones that are on there. We mock ourselves. We need to pray and fast like our lives depend on it. You know, when the time that we do spend complaining and wishing is turned into the time where we pray and fast, then and only then will we be able to achieve what Jesus really wants us to achieve. Point number two, sometimes it has to get worse before it gets better. I remember hearing this as a lesson 20 years ago, and it made me laugh my socks off. I was like, that doesn't sound good. In Mark 9:19, says, you unbelieving generation, Jesus replied, how long shall I stay with you? How long shall I put up with you? bring the boy to me. So Jesus came down and said, we can't do it. He said, bring the boy to me. So they brought him. When the spirit saw Jesus, it immediately threw the boy into a convulsion. He fell to the ground and rolled around, foaming at the mouth. Jesus asked the boy's father, how long has he been like this? From childhood, he answered. It has often thrown him into the fire or water to kill him. But if you can do anything, take pity on us and help us. If you can, Jesus said, everything is possible for the one who believes. Immediately the boy's father exclaimed, I do believe, help me overcome my belief. When Jesus saw the crowd was running to the scene, he rebuked the spirit. You deaf and mute spirit, he said, I command you, come out of him and never enter him again. The spirit shrieked, convulsed him violently, and came out. The boy looked so much like a corpse that many said, he's dead. Jesus took him by the hand and lifted him to his feet and stood up. You know, when we have a lack of faith, how do you think God feels about that? Our lack of faith offends God. One of the things about faith is, I just don't have faith. Like, in brackets, that's okay. That's not okay. He's like, how long do I have to put up with you? Man, I've healed this guy, I've healed this guy, I've walked on water for you, I've fed the 5,000, the 4,000. I mean, what the heck is wrong with you? I have done so much in your life. What the heck is wrong with you? That's what Jesus is saying. He's going, man, what more do I need to do? It's like, imagine my son coming in, growing up, and from 5 years old, he comes in and he goes, Dad, will you feed me today? Will you look after me? Have we got enough money? Is Mum okay? He does that every day for 10 years. That would just be weird. I'd just be like, in the end, I'd just go, son, I'm offended now. Do you think I'm an idiot? Do you think I can't? Do you think Mum doesn't know where Coles is? I mean, what is wrong with you? Do you think I don't go to work? I just sort of go down the street, twiddle my thumbs for 8 hours and come back? I mean, I'd be like, this is a stupid conversation. When we don't have faith in God, it's a stupid conversation. He is all powerful. He created everything, in charge of everything, totally and utterly in love with us because we have given our life to Jesus. What is the issue? The issue is not God. And I wonder how the disciples felt when he said, how long do I have to put up with you? You know, it's almost like an insult. Geez, am I that thick? The man says, if I can. He's like, what do you mean, if? I mean, we have a real mindset switch we've got to do here. We've got to understand who we worship. And that's why our quiet times are so good. You know, sometimes I hear people, you know, they just listen to the Bible. Or they just, you know, they do a couple of scriptures, tick a box, and go to work. That is not reading the Bible. How on earth are you gonna get to know someone? When I get to know someone, you know what I do is I ask questions. I go, what do you mean by that? Who are you? What do you? So let's look at the Bible in front of us going, what am I meant to change from? What did Jesus mean by this? Help me meditate on that. Write it on a card, take it to work and think about it, digest it, discuss it with your friends. How on earth are you going to get to know God? Quiet times aren't ticking the boxes. They're there to help us change radically from the inside out. He goes, help me overcome my unbelief. I'll show you how to overcome your unbelief. You ready for this? You really want to change? I don't think you do. Okay. Don't want to ask a question. Well, the first thing is really, really easy. You write out your past miracles and all your answered prayers. But it's a really easy one. Think of all the things God has done in your life. Thank God for them. If you're struggling to believe that you've been fruitful, just thank God for the last person you were fruitful for. It's really simple. If you're praying to have money and you've got none, just thank God for the last time you had money. Because there'll be many times you'll be praying that prayer. The second thing is read the Bible specifically about what you are struggling with. You read stories where you relate, you go, that's me. Oh, and it turned out okay. And that's me. Oh, and it turned out okay. You say, well, I feel like if I stand up for God at work, I'll lose my job and I'll just die. Right, let's go to Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Is your boss about to throw you in a big hot furnace? I don't think so. And what happened at the end of the story? They got a promotion. I mean, you use the Bible to change your heart. But turn your Bibles to Hebrews 11. I had a conversation with Sean and Tegan. I'm sorry if I disturb you, your syllabus gets thrown around. And they were talking about special contribution. We were talking about how much you can do for Hong Kong. And he said, well, Joe, I think I've got this wrong. He said, I sort of went back to West and went, how much would you like to give? He said, people said they're going to give 5,000. You need to say that, right? I expect 5,000. He goes, well, I don't think I've got this a little bit wrong. I said, right, we don't make up wish lists. You don't make goals with the intention to not hit them. That is not a goal. If we started to teach that in the church, nothing would happen. Everybody's faith would die. You make a goal, you figure out how to do it. We had quite a heated lunch over Tegan's favorite burger. But that's called discipling. In Hebrews 11, verse 11, I said, let me show you these scriptures. It says, and by faith, even Sarah, who was past childbearing age, was enabled to bear children because she considered him faithful who made the promise. You see, our problem is, when we get faithless, we talk about us and our situation. And when you don't understand, and he, and she, and I. Sarah went, ain't no way in heck that I'm going to have a baby. And look at this body. If I start to focus on what I've got or where I'm at in life, I ain't having a baby. The only way this is going to happen is I focus on God. She considered him who made the promise faithful. When people start, we have this conversation, she'll say, well, you've got to say, I, these, and them, and I. I go, this is faithless talk. Be quiet. You're telling me all the facts. You're not talking about God. And then Hebrews 11, verse 17. And I love this. This, again, once I got this years ago, this changed me. One reason I don't preach a lot about faith is I get it now. Which is one of my mistakes. You know, when you get something, you forget that other people don't get it. But in Hebrews 11, 17, it says, by faith, when God tested him, offered Isaac as a sacrifice. He who had embraced the promises was about to sacrifice his one and only son. Even though God had said to him, it is through Isaac that your offspring will be reckoned, Abraham reasoned that God could even raise a dead, and so in a manner of speaking, he did receive Isaac back from death. Unbelievable passage if you grasp it. Abraham is told, through your child Isaac, all generations will come. Then God says, kill him. Illogical. See, when we have a lack of faith, we go, these two scriptures don't match up. The situation I'm in and what the scripture says do not match up. Why is Abraham called our father of faith? He did something that was mind-blowing. He created the concept of resurrection. This is mind-blowing. He goes, son needs to die. Son needs to produce children. The only way that this is possible, if there is a brand new concept called resurrection, I'm going to believe in something that does not exist in any human being's mind up to this point. That's mind-blowing. That's absolutely mind-blowing. What is faith? Faith is figuring out how to get what God wants you to do done. If you look at all the people in the book of Hebrews, they get it done. They're people who just get it done. Some of them in terrible ways. I mean, at the beginning of Samson's life, it goes, this man will bring about the beginning of the downfall of the Philistines. And instead of him being really blessed throughout his life and being godly, he lives a dog of a life, sleeps with prostitutes, but at the end, after his eyes have been gouged out, he stands with his hands on the pillar, brings down the temple of Dagon, and all the Philistine leaders are killed. He achieved the purpose of his life. That's why he's in the book. Faith is about seeing the target, making it happen, and figuring out absolutely everything in between. You know, there are always people with faith. You know, I'm so proud, as Jeremy said, and Jeremy really sparked a lot yesterday. He did a great job. His family's kids, over 2,000 kids playing soccer, and went, I'm not going to send Tivoli Park. Here's where the good sugar is. And he did a great job in that. But you know what? In one day, with all the hard work of the bakers, the Church for Mercy raised $3,000. They figured out how to do it. So, is there any excuse for people not raising special contribution? No, why? Actually, you could go to Costco, buy cupcakes, and repeat exactly what happened this week, and just go and do exactly the same and raise $2,000. There's no excuse. There are ways to figure it out. You know, I emailed because Los Angeles, who funded our church, had just finished their special. I said, can I have a lot of good stories there? Because it's always great to build your faith. Over the last 2 months, in the center in Inglewood, which is, yeah, straight out of Compton, Inglewood, they've been tagging every day. Not every day, every weekend. Okay, that's with buckets, no cupcakes, just go, give us money for missions. They raised $30,000. That's it. Mason, who was here, they were trying to raise money for the conference. And they go, we're trying to raise money to get students to the conference. One man stopped and said, I'm paying for all your students, here's $2,000. His faith is in God. That's what we can look at, being two people being met and converted just from cupcakes. I think about one brother, you want to talk about sacrifice? He decides to go and give his bone marrow. I mean, that's, I'm like, he said, well, I can do it, there's people in need. Bone marrow, I'm going to get paid for that. You know what? Some people love the mission and they're prepared to do anything. I think even one sister who lost her sight as a teenager, who was on a meager salary, through her friend she's raised $1,400 for the mission field. And of course, some of that money is going to Hong Kong. So what's our excuse? There are so many different things. I want you to pray today. I've contacted Jimmy, who leads the church in Melbourne, not part of our movement. I said, Jimmy, can you go to your church? And just go, you know what? Ask them all for donations. Let's get it all going. There are so many reasons why we can say, I can't do it. But Jeremy Ross got stuff off Gumtree and sold it. I mean, they raised all their special this, and they've done it this. They've already given their special this year. Both times. They were just able to do it. Every one of us has the ability to raise it. The difference is, one person speaks by faith, and another man speaks by sight. We can all be men of faith. You know, there's a real process of change here. When Jesus commands this spirit to come out of the void, it's amazing because the guy takes him to Jesus. Jesus tells him he can help him. But what actually happens is as soon as he meets Jesus, the boy starts throwing around and the demon comes alive. So much so, it says after Jesus throws him out, it looks like the boy is dead. I think the father felt at that time. Nice job, Jesus, killed him. You know what, that's what can happen sometimes when we try and do something with faith. You go, I've just got faith, and you push forward and it's almost like you're worse off. Sometimes things go worse. I know when we study the Bible with people, this is so the way. You meet someone, they're excited, they come to church, they love it, this is great, I found my church, it's wonderful. It's not only seeking God the Word. Oh, you're my best friend. Discipleship. Oh, light and darkness. And then you don't see them. They disappear like Scotty for 3 months. They go back to their old church and they sit there and they go, maybe this is good. It wasn't so bad after all. But then you know what? Scotty walked back in and went, you're right. That's happened to so many people. Pete, it's typical. Pete studied the Bible in LA. It was his friend that was studying, actually. And he was just sort of listening in. Studied the Bible, saw he wasn't a Christian, hated it, got really angry at the guys. Rah! But I'm never coming back. Cycling in the middle of LA, gets hit by a car. First of all, gets angry at the car. And then goes, heck, I just nearly died. Burns up the brothers, go. You know, I'm so proud of Pete. There was tears of joy on Jesus. Pete, without doubt, everybody's been faithful on mission field, but he has been the faithfulest of all missionaries. Pete Paulino, we talk about this time when, through all the challenges, he'd get his residency, bring up his kids in Australia and all of that, and it's been so tough. And as a result, I've asked Pete to preach next week because he's on. So this week, he and Paulina got their residency.
Come on.
So he's going to sort of live the sermon that goes, it got worse before it got better. And I promised him, next Sunday, we'll be on our Sunday best. We're taking Pete Paulina out on the Westfield Rotunda restaurant. Okay, I said, that's a promise, baby. We're just going to be there. We're going to share and love and eat as much as we want, look out. Because you need to celebrate a good time.
Yeah.
There are so many people, though. Now, I did ask Beric if I could share. I love Beric. Beric is one of those people where the sin's on the outside. You never need to worry about people with sin on the outside. People when you've got Beric sin on the inside.
Yeah.
But Beric came to church. We studied the Bible, but I did ask her if I could share this. She came and sat right at the back. I was like, she didn't sit still at all. You're right, Beric. And it was just like, I wonder if I believe in demon possession anymore. I did ask you if I could share. The reason that I share that is because sometimes we need so much faith in ourselves and a situation. Or the people that are studying the Bible. You're Beric now. Sweet, isn't it? She is awesome. She's fantastic.
Yeah.
You know, I think so many of the people we study the Bible with, it's not over. We're upset that they've left. It's the most stunning one I've ever been personally involved with. I was in the London church, and it was the 10th year anniversary. And we're recognizing this guy. His name's Nick Giorgio. Hi, Nick, if you're watching. And he said, I came to this church 10 years ago when it just started. They studied discipleship with me, and I said, it will never work. You'll never convert people. I've been here, and I've not converted people. I'm in the traditional church of Christ, and it doesn't work, evangelism. They went, okay. So we evangelize him 10 years later. He walks in. The church is 1,200. There's 2,000 people on Sundays. He said I was wrong. So I studied the Bible with him again. We go to discipleship. I said, you do realize, Nick, now you've seen the proof. You're not really a disciple. He flipped out, stormed out of my house. How dare you? I'm like, Nick, 10 years, what? Nothing's happening. Your church is here. I'm not saying we're the greatest, but 1,206. Okay. Storm now. Middle of the night. Banging on my door. I see it. I get it. Let me in, please. I get it. I'm going to repent. Got baptized and still in our London church.
Wow.
10 years. You know, sometimes it has to get worse before it gets better. It just tests our steel. It just tests our steel. You know, why do things happen or don't happen in our life? What's your problem? It's you. Don't talk to me about why not being fruitful. Don't talk to me about special contribution. Don't talk to me about the Holy Spirit lives in you. You're a power of God. The problem is you and the problem is me. Church doesn't go well, you know whose fault it is? It's my fault. I get decided to go, what's wrong with your church? It's me. Just need to own up. And then, sometimes it gets better as it gets worse. You know, today, I've got to share about Gabriel. This is a cool story. And his mum and dad are here when I honour his mum. We love to welcome the parents. We love to work as a team on the students to make sure they get good grades and everything. That's so I know. Tim's dad is waiting for a call, I'm sure, in there right now. But Gabriel, Ian Brandon are evangelizing. And they decide, okay, let's go. So Ian goes off. Sorry. Brandon goes, I'll just invite one more. So he invites this guy. The guy goes, I'm not interested. But my roommate is. He goes, well, how do I get in contact with my roommate? They've got a clue. There's Brandon's fingers guy. He hasn't got a clue who he is. It's Gabriel. Now they're hooking up. I mean, just totally gone. Starts to come along. We start to study the Bible. Great heart. Pure heart. Loves God. Talks about God all the time. We start to see there's some things that he just hasn't got. That's the way we all were, right? Most of us just, we love God, but we just didn't quite get everything. But let's be honest, how long does it take to get everything? I'm 50 this year, I still ain't got everything. I mean, just, there's always a few missing pieces, okay? And then he just goes, well, I realize I haven't done it well. But it's so overwhelming. It's so challenging. He goes, don't know if I can do it. And there's a couple of days where we're like, where's Gabriel? But he's working out with God. He's praying. He's figuring it all out. And then he pops back up on Monday. Hello! I figured out, but remember, I had to get a little bit worse before it got better. And now today, Gabriel will be your brother in Christ. The only reason why the next 6 weeks up to the conference is not going to be great for you is because you decided for it not to be. As for me and my beautiful wife and our family, we've decided this is going to be some pretty cool 6 weeks. Special.